Welcome to the fourth video in our end-to-end testing series. We'll be looking at a permissive, underreaching transfer trip, or PUTT communication-assisted trip scheme in this video. I'm going to assume that you've watched all the previous videos in this series, so I won't rehash what to look for in this animation. If you haven't watched the previous videos, stop now and click this link to watch them first so that you can follow along. We talked about a DTT and DUTT teleprotection scheme in the previous video, and we're talking about a PUTT scheme today. These acronyms can be confusing, so let's break down the code to help you figure out what they mean. If the scheme starts with the letter D, the D can stand for direct or directional. Relays that do not share information back and forth are in a direct scheme. One relay simply tells the other relay to trip, and the other relay follows the command. The TT at the end of the acronym stands for transfer trip. This means that a remote relay is sending a trip signal to the other side. If I told you we were going to test a DTT scheme, you could translate the acronym to mean direct transfer trip, where direct tells you that you don't need any fancy GPS or iRig connected equipment to test this scheme. Transfer trip tells you that one relay will send a trip signal to the other, and there could be another letter telling you which zone to apply, but it's missing from this acronym, so that means there will be an external signal initiating the transfer trip, like a breaker failure relay or a 52B signal, that will isolate both sides of a line if one breaker operates. If I told you we were testing a DUTT scheme, you could infer that direct means that no fancy time-synced test equipment will be required on both ends. The U stands for underreaching, therefore one relay will need to measure a zone 1 signal to send a trip to the other side. A relay test set will be required for this test, and transfer trip tells you that one relay will send a trip signal to the other. Today we're looking at a PUTT scheme, and the P stands for permissive. A permissive scheme tells the other relay that it is allowed to trip faster if it also detects a fault in the correct direction. Both relays must agree that there is a fault before a permissive trip, unlike the direct scheme that would send a trip signal if only one relay detected a fault. Permissive schemes share information back and forth, so you will need your fancy GPS and/or iRig connected equipment on all sides of the line. The U stands for underreaching. Therefore, at least one relay must measure a zone 1 fault for this scheme to work. TT means that one relay is sending a transfer trip signal to the other. We're looking at a PUTT animation that you can find on our website, relaytraining.com. There should be a link on the screen right now that you can open in a new window if you want to follow along. The link can also be found in the description below. Which elements will pick up in Relay 1 if a fault occurs close to Relay 1, as we show here? Which elements will pick up in Relay 2? Zone 1 and Zone 2 will pick up in Relay 1 because the fault is closest to Relay 1, while only Zone 2 will pick up in Relay 2. Which relay will trip first? Relay 1 will trip instantaneously because of the Zone 1 pickup, but it will also send a PUTT signal to the other relay because it has detected an underreaching fault on the line. We call zone 1 an underreaching condition because it is purposely set somewhere between 75 to 90% of the line so that it will never operate for a fault that's not on the line. So right now the fault is still on the line even though relay 1 tripped and current is flowing through relay 2. How long will it take before Relay 2 trips? Relay 2 would normally trip after a 20 to 40 cycle Zone 2 time delay in a normal impedance protection scheme, but we're using a PUTT scheme here. Relay 2 receives a permissive underreaching transfer trip signal from Relay 1. If Relay 2 receives permission to trip from Relay 1 and it detects a fault on the line via the Zone 2 pickup, it is allowed to trip faster after a small communication time delay. So Relay 2 is going to trip in a significantly shorter amount of time using a PUTT scheme compared to your traditional distance schemes. Let's look at another fault on the line. This fault is a mirror image of the previous one. Which elements will pick up in Relay 1 and Relay 2? This time, Relay 2 sees a Zone 1 and Zone 2 pickup, while Relay 1 sees a Zone 2 pickup. Why do I keep harping on these easy questions about pickup in these examples? Communication-assisted protection schemes like PUTT and POT use pickup detection to decide what to do, and most relay testers are laser-focused on what trips inside the relay. So I want to make sure that you think in pickup terms and not trip terms when you're evaluating end-to-end test results. Which relay will trip first, and how long will it take to trip the other relay? This time, Relay 2 will trip instantaneously because it detected a Zone 1 fault, and Relay 1 should trip in 20 to 40 cycles because it detects a Zone 2 fault, which means that the relay does not know whether the fault is on the line or not. However, Relay 1 confirmed that the fault was on the line with its PUTT signal. Therefore, Relay 1 has permission to trip after a short time delay and then indicate a communication trip on its front panel. Now let's look at how the permissive underreaching transfer trip scheme compares to a regular distance protection scheme. Our standard protection scheme is at the top of the animation and the PUTT scheme is at the bottom. Watch what happens in each scheme as I cycle through the original fault. We have a fault that is closer to relay 1. Which elements will pick up in each relay? Did you choose correctly? Notice that both schemes have identical operating characteristics so far. Relay 1 sees a Zone 1 and Zone 2 fault, while Relay 2 sees a Zone 2 fault. Which relay should trip first? Relay 1 trips first in both schemes because they both detect a Zone 1 fault. When would Relay 2 trip in the standard and PUTT schemes? Relay 2 trips after 20 cycles in the standard scheme and almost instantaneously using the PUTT scheme because there were two pairs of eyes that verified that the fault was on the line. The Zone 2 delay only exists because one Zone 2 detection by itself can never be sure whether the fault is on the line or outside the zone of protection. Will the two schemes perform differently if the fault happens 50% down the line? Any fault in the overlapping region of Zone 1 will trip instantaneously on both sides because both relays see Zone 1. There is no need for fancy teleprotection schemes for those faults. What happens when the fault is not on the line and relays 3 and 4 are disabled? Which elements will pick up in each relay? Relay 1 will detect a Zone 3 fault, and Relay 2 will detect a Zone 2 fault. What will happen next? Will Relay 1 operate? Will Relay 2 operate as a normal protection scheme? Or will it trip faster using a PUTT scheme? Relay 2 will operate after its usual Zone 2 time delay because it will not get permission from Relay 1 to trip faster. That's the dirty little secret of communication-assisted trip schemes. They are only installed to trip faster if the fault occurs beyond Zone 1 to the end of the line. All of this time, money, effort, and extra testing technology only saves us 20 to 40 cycles inside a very narrow window. Why do we do it? The primary reason is system stability. There have been studies of the power system that show a relationship between fault duration and system stability. That 20 cycles of fault current could cause a much larger outage for every extra cycle that the fault stays on the line. So we want it off as soon as possible. Thanks for watching this video. I hope you have some new insights into how a permissive underreaching transfer trip communication assisted trip scheme works. You can play with this animation and more by following the link on the screen. You can also get more information about testing these schemes via the Relay Testing Handbook End-to-End Testing via the other link in this video or in the description below. As always, please like this video and subscribe to our channel to let Google know that we have good stuff. It helps us get notice and allows us to keep putting out free content like this with no ads. And in the end, don't forget to have fun out there. Have a great day.